take this unique opportunity here and welcome CEO Kyle Floyd here. He's the CEO of Vox Royalty. Just completed my deep dive of the company, founded in 2014, and really looking forward to this. Get to hear it right from the boss's mouth. What we've got going on, exciting stuff as we get into this interview. Kyle, thank you so much for coming on to the show this evening. Give us a quick rundown for those investors that are not familiar with Vox Royalty. If you'd be so kind, tell us a little bit about yourself and the exciting things you've got going on with Vox Royalty.
Absolutely, Ryan. It'd be my pleasure. So Vox Royalty Corp was founded back in 2014, and it was created to solve a problem. And the problem that I saw in the markets was that investors needed more exposure to commodities and frankly wanted more exposure to commodities, but couldn't trust the platform for that exposure, whether it was mining companies, whether it was ETFs, whether it was the physical, you name it, all of those outlets for exposure really came with really subpar risk-adjusted returns. And so royalty companies for the last 25 years have outperformed the physical and really any commodity-based benchmark that you compare them to, also the S&P 500. And so in 2013, 2014, I started building a concept that I believed would present better risk-adjusted exposure to investors that weren't commodity experts, weren't mining engineers, weren't geologists, hadn't been in the industry investing for the better part of two decades, but to allow an opportunity for, you know, your everyday investor that wants that exposure, especially in an inflationary time like we find ourselves in today, to find a vehicle and to find, you know, in this case, a stock and a company that really has you know, the right intentions in terms of building value for shareholders and the right capability to do so as well. And so that's kind of the genesis of Vox Royalty Corp and a little bit on my background. And so what we do is we go out around the world and we look at interesting event-driven catalysts typically on mining assets. And what we do is we buy what's called third-party royalties. Those are royalties that are held by, say, the prospector, geologist, or junior mining company that typically was responsible for finding the geological anomaly in the first place, and then buying those assets from them. So they have nothing to do with the operations of the mine, but that asset, that royalty asset, what that really means is that they will get a percentage of the revenue generated from that mine, typically for the life of that mine. And so we go buy those. And by buying those, we get the same exposure that you get in terms of the upside of owning a mining company. Upside exposure to the metal price, upside exposure to expansion of resources and reserves and expansion of production. So we get all that upside, and that really typically tends to be leveraged upside, but with a lot less downside. We're never on the hook for putting more money into that company. When they have cost overruns, that doesn't impact us. When there's inflation on your costs as a mining company, because they're impacted by inflationary pressures as well, we don't have that. We have a very, you know, relatively smaller fixed cost structure that doesn't share that variable cost structure that a mining company does. So we limit a lot of the risk, but realize just as much upside, if not more, and we're never diluted. Our interest in that revenue is never diluted. So a lot to unpack there, and a little bit more verbose, but I wanted to give your viewers a really good kind of nutshell perspective on what Vox does.
I think that's really important when you touched on the diversification element. I typically stay away from the junior mining space altogether, because even if I own a basket of a half a dozen of them, that's only a half a dozen. Whereas if I get exposure to Vox, now I'm not only geographically diverse, I'm diverse across, you know, a number of different precious metals applications. So they don't all have to work at the same time. Am I thinking about that right, Kyle?
It's absolutely right. I mean, we have 55 streams and royalties. And so that's across a multitude of projects. I believe it's 53 projects, separate projects, and I believe it's more than 40 separate operators. So the diversification is real. The other thing is, we went public in May of last year. To give your viewers a little bit more background, we went public with one production stage asset. We now sit at five production stage assets. We're expected to have 10 production stage assets by the time we exit 2023, with, I believe, upside to that number that won't count additional acquisitions that we can make. Yeah. And then 17 in the portfolio, we feel really confident are going to be in production over called the medium term. Well, if you look at 10 producing assets that are generating revenue for our business, to get that type of exposure in a mining company, you're talking about a very large cap, typically probably $5 to $10 billion plus mining company that has that many producing assets. You get that level of diversification and all the upside that comes along with it in a $120 million market cap company like Vox. So you get the upside with a lot less risk. And that was the entire premise of building this company over the last decade, was that we could offer that for investors with the right kind of discipline, the right kind of team, and the right kind of competitive advantages that we built.
It's incredible, Kyle. So I picked up on this with your producing now at 5, soon to be 10, going into 2023. Let's talk about the other side of the spectrum with your intellectual property, with your 8,000 existing royalties in your database. You guys are the standalone company that can boast this. Give me some sort of an idea of the range of the tip of the iceberg, which is your producing assets, and what that database means for your business.
The database is hugely helpful. What we have built our business around is kind of three key legs of the stool. And the one of those legs is the database. This and everything working to find the best deals at the best valuation for our shareholders in volume as well. But one of those legs is our database. So that's 8,000 proprietary royalties that we're able to utilize when we find an asset that's had an interesting development that we believe is worth doing more work on. Then if our mining engineers and our geologists like what they're seeing, then we go into our database and we see if there's a royalty over that project that we can go buy. The other leg of that stool is absolutely the management team and our technical capabilities to analyze the mining asset on behalf of our shareholders. And that's the key. It is around creating shareholder value, but you know, a lot of times you're dealing with assets. Look, the mining industry is esoteric. It's not, you know, a widget. We're not widget manufacturers. We're not a tech company with a certain amount of users and eyeballs. You kind of need a really nuanced and detailed level of experience to analyze these projects. And our mining team has that. We built around that. So they're mining engineers, they're geologists. They're able to really understand the project and the development opportunities for these projects and the risks that go alongside of that. And so when they look at a royalty or they look at a project and they like it and there's a royalty that exists on it, we've gone into the database to find that. Then the last leg of the stool that sometimes and often comes into play is over the last decade, we've built a relationship and an apparatus with deal sourcing agents that help us find the owners of these disparate royalties all over the world. So whether it's the Ivory Coast or it's in Argentina or in the bush of Western Australia, we're able to, if we don't have a person on the ground there, to get in touch and make it personal in terms of our ability to transact and buy that royalty from what that, you know, for that group, it's typically a non-core asset, which means they're typically more interested in selling. And so that's how the whole model works together to find really great value for our shareholders in volume.
Your team, specifically your technical team, has been killing it over the last couple of years. 24 transactions in the last since 2019. Can you put that into context compared to your peers out there? If I was looking across the landscape, what sets Vox Royalty apart from your peers?
It's certainly growth, and I think it's quality of growth. And if you compare it to, say, some of the very large cap names in our industry, these are multi-billion dollar companies. They've been around now for 20 plus years in some cases. There are years that they won't do a single transaction. And that's okay for them. Then there's a middle group of companies that will do maybe 2 to 3 transactions. But us completing more than 24 separate transactions, bringing in more than 40 royalties over the last 2 years is unprecedented. In the history of the industry, it is unprecedented. But it's not the growth. Well, we have led the industry in growth in almost every respect, quantity of royalties acquired, revenue growth, kind of you name it, we've led the industry in relative growth. So what I would say is the most important thing that separates us though is our ability to find really deep value in how we are able to acquire royalties. We're not paying premiums to bring in royalties. We're finding them at really good value. And that's what's really moving the needle. So when we look at metrics like return on invested capital, we're really blowing away the competition and the industry in that capacity. And I think for our investors, that's what really matters the most. That's the most tangible validation and value creating initiative that our firm can possibly bring forth for our shareholders.
So what Kyle's talking about there for our would-be patrons to the message, visit voxroyalty.com and you can catch a lot of the interviews done by Spencer. Spencer breaks this down in a way that what an asset for the company, you know, to find these deals and to apply the three-tier criteria that you're talking about to push those transactions. Talk a little bit about your geopolitical involvement, right? You got about 80% of the assets that are over in Australia. It's worth spending a few moments to touch base and really kind of understand why the focus is there in those tier one countries, Australia, Canada, and the US, of course. But let's spend a few moments, if you wouldn't, just highlight us on why Australia, if you would, Kyle.
It's one of the things I could go on and on for hours, which we don't have, unfortunately, Ryan. But what we've built, I think, is really special. We have the second largest holding of hard rock mining royalties on the continent of Australia. And most of those are in Western Australia, which last year was ranked by the Fraser Institute as the best mining jurisdiction. That agency does a pretty good job, but it does oscillate depending on where people are investing capital. But what I would tell you is from an on the ground perspective, it is the best mining jurisdiction to build a gold mine. It has one of the fastest turnaround times from discovery to production of any jurisdiction on the planet. The rule of law is fantastic. As a royalty holder, you want good rule of law. You want that no matter what mining assets and however you've invested in those. But the quality of the people, the quality of the rule of law, the quality of the geological endowments that we have royalties over, all of that make it, in my opinion, by far the best mining jurisdiction, and by far the best mining jurisdiction to have royalties that are linked to such quality assets. And so what we've built is really a very low geopolitical risk portfolio. And that, you know, the bigger players in our space traded a premium when they have a lot of Nevada exposure. Well, Western Australia is a better place to be than Nevada. And that's saying something, because Nevada is truly a great mining jurisdiction. Us having the second largest holding of hard rock mining royalties there is worth a premium, in my opinion, at the end of the day. We don't get that yet. I think we will. But that low geopolitical risk, we do have some assets. We have an asset that's in, just came into production in Nigeria. We sold royalties that were in Madagascar. We have certainly had assets at various points in time and still do in what would certainly not be called tier one jurisdictions. But the fact that we have 80% of our royalty assets are over North American or Australian projects means our investors can sleep well at night that those are in some of the best jurisdictions you can possibly be in. But what we're seeing is the growth, especially in Western Australia, is driving so much value in our portfolio that's, you know, I think yet to be fully appreciated in terms of our stock price.
I concur. I was looking over my deep dive, doing my due diligence on Vox Royalty, and I kept earmarking value in a lot of different pockets of your business. Let's talk about the stock. Stock is doesn't fit into this camp. You're trading right now at about 0.7 net asset value. Compared to your peers, it just doesn't stack up. You're about half of what the industry normally garners for a royalty company. 2% up today, trading at about 258 at the time of filming this video here. But you guys just came off a blowout quarter. It was impressive all the way across. Bottom line, gross profits of $1 million. Bottom line, net income too, 1.3 of net income. You guys blew it away, and you're guiding at 100% here for Q3. So what's being missed here, Kyle? I hate to touch on a sore spot, but it was the only sore spot that I could find. So what gives?
Yeah, we're pretty candid with what our weaknesses are and what we have to improve. I absolutely can tell you the fundamentals of our business are going so solidly in the right direction. And that's a testament to the competitive advantages that we built, the hard work of the team and the capabilities of our team. And the execution that we've brought forth for our investors has been very, very significant. You know, in terms of guidance, look, you're absolutely right. We doubled guidance for the year. You know, last quarter was amazing. We had a couple really big things that I think really drove a lot of value. One was we sold royalties that we acquired for a multiple of what we acquired. We also believe there's, you know, a bunch of upside. We vended those royalties out to a company called Electric Royalties. They just fit better in their portfolio. We're more precious metal focused, so there are a lot of synergies on that transaction. Also, we have, while most of our business is oriented towards precious, we had a blowout quarter because iron ore was at all-time high prices. And so that, you know, that's the upside that you get when you're picking the right assets, is those types of things happen. And that allowed us to double our revenue guidance for what it had been previous to a month and a half ago. And so, yes, the fundamentals are improving. But when it comes to the stock price, you know, Ryan, what I would say is we're pretty direct on where we need to improve. One of the big areas that we needed to improve upon was we had been a private company for a while. We're not a, you know, while we just went public in May, we're not a new company. There are the new companies that have entered this space and they kind of are chasing it. And they don't really have any competitive advantages. They don't really, you know, frankly, have a bunch of expertise in the space, but they're there because it is a very, very good business model when executed well. But we've been around for a while, but we were private. And there is a, you know, frankly, I think I underestimated the learning curve and some of the experience that needed to be gained to be a successful publicly traded business. And a lot of that is the right kind of investor awareness and making sure that, hey, that old proverbial saying that if a tree falls in the woods and no one's there to hear it, doesn't really make a sound. I think that applied to us a little bit, but that's our fault. And we're working on that. And we are, I think, getting much better exposure now. We're putting the effort that needs to be put into that capacity of the business to be successful for our shareholders, to make sure that people understand Vox is a very viable option for commodity exposure. And we believe the right kind of opportunity for a lot of investors looking for that exposure.
From your perspective, Kyle, as the CEO, this is one of my selfish personal questions that I had in the back of my mind when I was doing my deep dive. What do you feel like in your perspective is going to be the sustainability over the short, medium, and longer term of Vox as some of these, you know, you're paying royalties expands? You do new transition and you're building the business out 5 years down the line, 10 years, and maybe even 20 years. Is there sustainability in a royalty company and especially for Vox?
Well, I think there's proven sustainability. If you look at Franco-Nevada, they've been around now in various forms for about 20 years. They went public, went private, came back public again. Wheaton Precious Metals is a streaming company, but very, very similar model to royalties. I think they started in 2004, so they're closing in on 20 years here. Royal Gold has been around for over 20 years. That's a NASDAQ-listed Denver-based company. So there's track record for companies being very, very successful over the long term. You know, I would love to run the business for 20 years. I think we, you know, the long-term value that would be created with us doing what we're doing over 20 years would be exponential in a lot of regards. But the reality is, I think we, you know, I don't know that we'll be around 20 years because our cost of capital is higher. When we're a small cap company, it's exceedingly higher than those companies that I just mentioned. Their cost of capital is low single digits. Ours is much higher than that. And so ultimately, I think, you know, we probably will make more sense for someone just to buy out. That has happened in the industry. And I think, you know, we could be running this company for 20 years and, you know, I probably love every second of it. I think at some stage, it probably makes more sense. There is consolidation happening in the industry. And for someone that has a lower cost of capital, that's immediate arbitrage value for their shareholders as well when we're acquired. So I'd say it's probably lower odds that we're around 20 years from now than, you know, being acquired over, call it the near or medium term.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. I appreciate the insight, Kyle, on that. Talk a little bit about your key producing assets, especially focused in the Australia and the Kulyanabing, Segalola, and the Janet Ivy. I saw just had a press release yesterday. So if you've got any new breaking news for our audience, that'd be awesome to touch on those key producing assets for us.
The really exciting part about these assets, Ryan, is that we bought most of them pre-production. I believe only one asset was in production, and that was the Brauna. That's the largest producing diamond mine in South America, for what that's worth. And that was the only asset that we bought that was presently in production. We bought that because we got it to call it 1.5x cash flow. I know you're a value investor, so I'll bring up some of the value investor themes that run through our business because we're the same. We just have a niche and a nuance and a capability to bring value forward for our shareholders. And so Brown was the only one that was in production. Then we have Dry Creek, which is three open pits that feed what's called the Higginsville operation in Western Australia. We bought that pre-production. We had intelligence that led us to believe that that would come into production over the near term. It exceeded our expectations, hit production sooner. That's been fantastic. That's bought at, you know, call it a 1.5x revenue. So we'll make multiples on our investment on that, multiples on multiples potentially. Same thing can be said for the Segilola Gold asset in Nigeria. We bought that at 1/4 of what we estimate that it will bring in for us over the next 3 years. It is capped. I'll always be candid. That's capped. So you get that optionality upside. But when you're expected to generate 4x what you purchased the royalty for over just a couple year time horizon, you absolutely take those deals. And that's part of the value play for us. Toyonami, same thing. We bought that royalty from that's a producing iron ore operation now for us. We bought that royalty from a telecom business. And that's, you know, when you ask, like, how does that database manifest in terms of creating value for your shareholders? Finding that royalty in a telecom business is a unique feat in its own right. And we bought that royalty prior to it being in production. It then came into production and has absolutely knocked it out of the park for us. We expect to make multiples on our money in that, on that investment as well. And I'm missing one that would be, we've named off Dry Creek, Browna, Segulola,
Janet Ivy.
Janet, and that's probably the biggest one. So we bought that royalty. We got intelligence that it's a big mining company, Zijin. So they're based at a Hong Kong listed $30 billion company. They have a subsidiary called Norton that runs some of their gold operations in Australia. And we essentially got intelligence that they were going to be working on commissioning what is now, and they're in process on now, is going to be the largest heap leaching project in all of Australia, which is saying something. So it's $400+ million of capital invested in it. But we bought a royalty for about $5 million that we had pretty, I mean, nothing's concrete in this world, but as good as you could feel about revenue potential as you possibly could on the near term. So we had it, it started producing. It's really about that ramp up that's happening right now. And so we bought it for five. We expect it to generate 20 or more for us at the end of the day over a 9-10 year time horizon. And there's a lot of upside baked in there. So that we expect will be realized. But that's what we look for. So, you know, your thesis of looking for value, we find value. Most of our competition is actually buying royalties because of the option value. Look, there is option value in royalties, and that's what we do. That Janet Ivy royalty has upside potential beyond that $20 million of revenue to us that we purchased for five. It has a lot of upside potential. We don't price a lot of that in when we're buying these assets, obviously, but they exist. Other royalty companies, they're basically buying assets that the gold price needs to run. There needs to be discoveries that happen that increase the total size of the resources and reserves. Production needs to increase just for them to get their money back. We're buying royalties that we expect to get multiples on our invested capital over, you know, rational, I would call them short-term duration. Mm-hmm. No one else in the industry has been able to do that. Not to the extent that we have with the volume that we have for our shareholders.
That's incredible. There's significant insider, 15% of you guys own the shares anyway. So there's some vested interest. Is something that I key off on a little bit. Another one of my questions, and you know, we're getting toward the end of the interview here, Kyle. Tell our investors how it is. And I typically don't cover royalty companies, so this was a real treat for me to kind of do a deep dive for you guys. But how is it that an investor that doesn't know a lot about royalty companies, how are we supposed to value a company? And you can answer this question on behalf of Vox Royalty and try to distinguish, you know, some of those similarities. What makes a good royalty company? What's the pedigree that exists? What are some of those things that we should be looking at as investors if we're going to be looking to take a potential investment or we're looking at your company?
It's a great question because there are certain relative valuation metrics that essentially survive in these industries. We are a niche or a nuance in, call it, the overall commodity sector. How you look at royalty companies, there's a couple of different key multiples to pay attention to. One is, and this is the most probably consistent across the sector, is relative valuation or relative multiple of net asset value. And net asset value is basically the discounted future value of your cash flow. And so we trade at 0.7 to 0.6 times net asset value, where most of our closest peers are trading at north of 1.5 times, but typically even north of 2 times net asset value. So just with what we have now, we would expect to realize a re-rating at some point for our shareholders. We're working very hard on that. Part of that's fundamentals driven. Part of that's investor awareness driven. But that's a very significant bump up in share price from where we stand today. The other multiple that you would look at would be cash flow. And some of our closest comps are trading at, and again, I'm not sitting here to validate some of these multiples, but I do point to them as references, are trading at 200 times revenue. And if you look at 2023 as our revenue starts to, and I think it's going to continue on the trajectory that's been on, but call it a normalized rate of, you know, analysts expecting it to be around 8 million, 8 to 10 million.
Correct.
We're trading at the low end of the range on that basis as well. So we have, I think, one of the most deeply discounted businesses in terms of share price and relative valuation that exists in the industry. We're starting to see momentum in the right direction. Some of the things that we needed to do better in terms of how we, you know, control stock that comes into the market and things like that, we've done. We've raised $30 million since we went public. We have no intention of going back to the markets to raise equity. So I think we've really now got the ship with a lot of momentum going the right direction. We fixed the things that we needed to fix so that the fundamentals could prove out and also be rewarded in share price.
You sure do. What did we miss, Kyle? For the viewers that tune into the channel, and there are a lot that are interested in your company, there's no doubt I'm one of them. What did we miss? We fill our investors in on something that we didn't highlight that you want to make sure and get through to our viewers.
Well, first of all, greatly appreciate the opportunity to be an independent investor. It's truly a privilege for me and for Vox Royalty Corp to be on the program. You know, what I would tell you is I built this company. The reason it was built was for a generalist investor that wants exposure to commodities. We obviously find ourselves in one of the most, difficult times from an inflation perspective of where do you put your investment? Where can you make money? And where can you, you can call it a hedge, or you can call it, I need to make money even when there's inflation, and I need to make more of it when there's inflation. Well, how do you do that? Because it's typically a deleterious time for most stocks and most industries. Whereas we usually have a tailwind from that type of thematic unfolding really before our eyes. So this business was built for this time. It just so happens, I mean, back when I founded the company and started building it in 2013, 2012, inflation was not at the top of everyone's minds, but I wanted to have that build an outlet that was reliable, that was straightforward, that offers investors the right risk-adjusted exposure without you having to be an expert in geology or mining engineering, but understanding that you have that exposure, you have that leveraged upside to metal prices, but you've got a lot less downside. And that comes in the form of just the quantity of assets that we have, both in production, coming into production, the different commodity mix that we present. Even though it's mostly precious metals, 70% precious, you still get the tailwinds that kick in when other metals do exceedingly well, like we've seen in iron ore and copper and other metals. So we've really tried to create a business that we believe distilled the best kind of value you could possibly be looking for when you're looking for a good investment in commodities. I think we've delivered that. And we're going to continue building shareholder value. So it's really about continuing to build what we've already started. We've got tailwinds to our business. The fundamentals continue to prove out. And I believe, we've got the momentum going in the right direction.
I review a lot of companies, Kyle, and I believe you will do that. Keep your nose to the grindstone. Keep leaning on that technical team, because I tell you what, you guys got an expertise that is unparalleled across the industry when compared to your peers. For the would-be investors, Canadian TSX Ventures, ticker symbol VOX. On the U.S. markets, it's OTC Quality Board Markets. Ticker symbol is VOXCF. If you didn't get that, I will provide all the description below for this video. Please, Kyle, if investors need further information, can you point them in the direction where they can find that stuff, please?
Yeah, so voxroyalty.com is a great place to start to continue to learn about our business. And if you want to get in touch with me or anyone on our team, ir@voxroyalty.com is the email address. We're obviously also on all the relevant social channels as well. But those are a couple avenues to get questions into us, or if you want more information, always happy to provide it and happy to engage.
Kyle, thank you so much for coming on the program. CEO Vox Royalty, Mr. Kyle Floyd, thank you so much for your time, sir. We're going to be putting you on the radar, and good luck to you into the future. A big, bright future for you going into forward. It's going to be awesome to track the progress of Vox Royalty. Thank you so much, Mr. Floyd.
Thank you, Ryan. It's been a pleasure. I appreciate it.
Thank you.